to fill a back room. Calling my name and I follow just to find you. I trace the faith to a broken down television and put on the weather. Then I've trained myself to give up on the past, cause I've frozen time between hearses and caskets. Lost control when I panicked at the acid test. I wanna get better.
Thank you. We got our live studio audience here with us. Thank you. You've got it tuned in to Muscatine Viewpoint, episode number 9. It's March 29th. If you've got it tuned in at about 6:35, you're watching the live broadcast where we'll be talking about the Muskie basketball season 2016-2017. We've got some highlights, some game clips, and some special guests that you're going to enjoy hearing from as we kind of celebrate every season successful in MHS athletics. But this one, we thought we'd bring some of the players out and some of the people that do the hosting. So we have them here, and their names are, we'll go ahead and introduce them because we want to get right into this. We've got Brian Mussehl, Jake, his youngest, and Joe Wieskamp. Welcome to the show, guys.
Thanks for having us, Chad.
We've got a lot to cover in this whole, we're going to recap this whole season for the folks at home. If you're tuning in, you know, Muskie basketball, you might have been, you might have heard that they had a pretty good year and some noteworthy performances by all the team. And you were there every step of the way. So let's just assume, you know, some people might not know you. But we want them to know who we're talking to. We'll start with you. Brian Mussehl.
I've been doing the Muskie games for KWPC Radio for 6 years now, and I've seen every game since. Well, I've seen every varsity game since Joe was a freshman, so I've seen all the boys' games throughout that time period, and it's been a great ride to watch these guys grow and develop, and back-to-back 15-win seasons, and we'll break some of that down here. Is pretty rare for Muscatine basketball, so they're certainly on the right track, and I think they're going to have a big year ahead again next year.
Yeah, let's talk. We'll talk about the legacy and whatnot as well if you've got some of that information. And you are a fan of Muskie sports in general. Tell us a little about what drives that.
Well, just the love of sports. You know, I'm actually from Dubuque. I went to Hempstead High School. I've been a Muscatine since 1984, so I've been here a long time. So it's been fun to watch the community grow. I mean, I got here when the football program was downtrodden, and then Jerry Teal came along and changed the fortune of that. And we've seen some very good basketball teams in the 90s, and there were some roller coaster rides. Coach Walsh did a great job in his 8-year run. And finally, the program was turning on the ledge. He had a great year last year at 15-8, and then he stepped down to spend time with his family, which is very commendable. Gary Belger came in his first year, moved in from Florida, a seasoned coach. He has 588 career wins when he took the job here, won 15 this year to get to 613. And so back-to-back 15-win seasons, both ending in sub-state losses. The program's going in the right direction right now, largely in part to Joe Wieskamp and a great cast of teammates that he's had.
Well put. And the coach didn't move up here just for the basketball position, or what's his story in it? And not sure, you can't speak for him, but that's a curious place to come from.
Coach should be here. Coach is in Florida, I believe, right, gentlemen?
Why wouldn't he be?
We think he's in Florida. So Coach Belger is not here tonight, so I can't really speak. He is only coaching basketball at the moment. They did not have a teaching position for him available when he took the job, but I think if he could get a teaching position, he would do both. But right now, he is just the basketball coach at Muscatine High School.
Well, that sounds like he's got some time to devote to the cause, and we can ask them about that. But thanks, Coach, for your efforts, and hopefully you'll get a chance to check this out in the rebroadcast. Okay, well, let's introduce Jake Mussehl. You're related to this man, youngest. We'll all talk about what that's like, but tell us a little about yourself. You go to high school, obviously, and your experiences on the team.
I'm a senior there. This is my second time playing, or second year playing varsity basketball. Like he said, we had two 15-game win seasons. So, I mean, it's just amazing being a part of the team and making new friends. I mean, that's the ultimate goal, is just having fun and being a part of the team. And then next year, I think they're going to really improve. I mean, they've got a lot of returning starters back. And obviously, Joe's the top one, so he'll keep scoring, and the other guys will fill in behind him.
So what other sports or activities are you involved with in high school? And then also, what are you doing next year?
Well, I played football 4 years, so I'm done with that. I played varsity 3 years, sophomore through my senior year. And then I'm also playing baseball, and it's coming up this summer again. And this will be my third year playing varsity baseball. And I'm going to the University of Iowa, and I'm going to study in sports management and recreation.
Oh, wow. Okay. So sports is a kind of a passion of yours, and you're going to move into that as a profession possibly.
Yeah.
University of Iowa Hawkeyes, that's where I went, so I'm all for that. And it looks like you'll be able to follow some of your teammates along the way. Good. All right, we'll get back to you as things happen. Okay, so Joe Wieskamp, tell us a little about yourself and your background on the team.
I'm a junior at the high school. I've started varsity for 3 years now. Came in and just tried to establish myself as a young guy. Just kind of continued to grow as the years progressed. I think I got a lot better going into my sophomore year, and then continued to grow as a junior, turning this program around, and I'm just very excited for next season to hopefully take us one step farther to the state tournament.
Okay, well put. I noticed that while I do some work for your dad occasionally, and he owns or is affiliated with a physical therapy center, and I know there was a sports performance component to that. Now, can you speak to, I would call that a secret weapon, but are you pretty, is your dad active in helping you develop some of your skills and some of those physical aspects, or talked about that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. My dad's always there pushing me to continue to work harder, helping me if I ever injure something. And then with having the sports performance with Scott Morrell, I'm able to go down and work out with him constantly. So having those connections with my dad and his job, just having those people around him to make me a better player has been very beneficial.
Great. Okay, so let's get into the game here. Now, if you're tuning in, it's March 29th. We've got some call-in options later, so if you want to talk to these guys or ask any questions about the season, you'll be able to get a chance to do that later. But we're going to kind of round out the season. We've got some highlights. Let's kind of go through it game by game, and we'll take a break every once in a while and talk about some other players and show some highlights. But what happened the very first game here?
Well, before we get to the highlights, we'll cover, because I think the highlights really start the second half of the season. The Muskies open on the road, and we talked about it on the radio. Jim Miller, I want to mention Jim, who is my partner on the radio, and the stat doctor, Mark Hansen, who helps us out during games. Eye doctor in town, we call him the stat doctor because he does a great job helping us out. And Jim and I aren't smart enough to do stats. So we have a lot of fun with that. But we knew that the Muskie basketball team, if they were going to be good, would start being really good mid-January to late January, because new coach moving in, they had to get familiar with each other. A lot of guys hadn't played many varsity minutes. I think there was Derek Webking, Drew Greenhaw, Jake, and Joe really were the only returning players with valuable playing time. So they go on the road, they play Iowa City High. They win 70-46 right out of the chute. And not their best effort, but City High was a little down this year, but it got them off in a winning column. They go to Cedar Rapids Prairie next. It was a yo-yo before Christmas. Prairie that night shot 62% from the three-point line, which was scorching hot, and beat us by 15, so we're square. Come home and beat Washington, Iowa. Then we go to Central, lose a tough game at Davenport Central by 3 in the last minute of the game. That was a tough one. Came home, Joe drops 50, and we beat Burlington at home by 40.
So that's kind of it seems like there's a turning point that sort
Correct.
Of happened. In that.
So we go.
50 points in one game is a lot of
points. 50
points
in a game. And it was phenomenal. It was great to see. Now, there were a lot of highlight games. We'll get to one. We'll get to what I'll mention later. What I thought of all of his great performances, there was a game later that his stat line was just off the charts, which I thought was the best I'd seen him play, which is saying something, because I've seen a lot of great performances. Then they go to North, which I thought really pre-Christmas was by far their worst effort of the year. The boys will agree at Davenport North. We couldn't throw it in the ocean that night.
Had a lot on their Christmas list.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then came home, beat PV before the break, which was a great win, 4-3. In the first game after the break, lose by 18 at Bettendorf. And they're 4-4, 2-3 in the MAC. And the season changed when they came home to host North Scott the next week.
Okay, so that's why we've got a highlight for that.
Correct.
Okay, so that's a nice recap of kind of what we got as far as building up to a highlight reel. So Chad Yoakum was there with you the whole way, and most of the games, pretty much everyone except for one, and filmed this. And
yes.
You worked with him, and he's got a highlight reel that he's sharing with us. So Alex, we'll take a look at that, and then we'll talk about what we saw with the players and yourself.
Drew bounces at the Web King. Now it's to Green out of Mussehl on the block. Now he kicks at the Web King for three. Good, Derek Web King. And we're tied at six with... Back at Muscatine High School, one quarter in the books. North very competitive. They led twice, 4-3 and 8-6, and the Muskies tied it at 8.
First quarter, Muskies shot 7 of 13, North 6 of 8.
Wieskamp long three, splash! Joe Wieskamp from 24 feet, and the Muskies go up 22-13 by 9. They get it to Mussehl. Mussehl kicks it to Mueller. Corner three. God, G Money gets it going. And they need him to go. That's his first basket. Ahead to Greenhawk. Greenhawk drives the lane. Gets it to Mussehl. He'll take a left wing three. Good. Jake Mussehl knocks down a three. Mueller, three ball out of the corner, no good. Tipped in by Bryce Howard, and it's good at the buzzer. Bryce Howard beat the buzzer. Corner, no good. Tipped in by Bryce Howard, and it's good at the buzzer. Tipped in by Bryce Howard, and it's good at the buzzer. Bryce Howard beat the buzzer. So Joe Wieskamp misses the front end, no big deal. This one's going in. Greenhawk comes in for Mussehl. And Wieskamp at the line now to shoot the second. Joe with 35, second free throw by Wieskamp's good. So we're tied at 64 with Mussehl in the front court. He drives in the lane on Murray, shot on the way, good! Jake Mussehl on a timeout, Muscatine. And he's trying to get it to Joe, now he does. Joe's got it with eight. Joe drives, kicks it to Falk. He swings it, Jack takes a 17-footer, good! Jackson Falk buries a free 17-footer, and we're going to double overtime. Jack Falk knocks down his first basket, or second basket of the night.
Okay, so.
That was actually, and that's probably on me, that was a Davenport North game. We wanted to talk about that because that was a thrilling home game, a double overtime thriller. And I mentioned we had a crowd shot because as the year progressed, and these guys can talk about it, the fan support and the student support at the high school was just phenomenal. I mean, the crowds at Muscatine, I would venture to say, and these guys can answer it, Muscatine, maybe the only exception of the Pit at North Scott, had to be the best home court advantage in the MAC.
Agree? Far, yeah.
Do you guys experience a home court advantage? You know, statistically, there's truth to that, but do you kind of feel that energy, or how do you combat when you're not at home?
I mean, usually when you're at home, when you're in the game, it's hard to hear the crowd. Yeah. I mean, you're just focused on the game, but when you're, like, on the bench getting a break, you actually look up, and there's everybody showing up. So, and they also show up to the away game, so they're always there.
Is that a factor when you're playing that you're aware of, or you're kind of hyper-focused on what has to happen regardless of the setting?
Yeah, I think the result showed. We only had one loss at home this season, so...
Okay.
Like Jake said, I think I just kind of focus and don't really hear the crowd, but it definitely gets your adrenaline going when you like are making shots and everything, so it's definitely good support.
So you had one loss at home, so that means that you folks at home are partly responsible for their winning season, so show up next year and we'll have an even better season, right? And there is some truth to that, though, especially basketball because of the close quarters, you know, statistically proven. Okay, so Davenport North, in what point of the season was this?
The Davenport North game, they were starting their role. This was, they'd only lost, they won 11-2 after they started 4-4. So North was later in the year.
Okay.
That was just a little bit out of sequence, and that's fine. North Scott's the game that, in my opinion, and these guys can answer it, that really changed their season. They hadn't shot really well all year, and they were very capable. Garrett Mueller, Jack, Jake, Joe, all these guys are really good three-point shooters. And they hadn't had a night where they just all went crazy.
Okay.
North Scott, they went crazy. And it was a lot of fun, and it took that because North Scott came into town, I think, with one loss, and they're ranked eighth in the state, and an outstanding team, a couple of Division I players on their roster. And, you know, Joe and Jack Folk especially got us going early in that one. And then Jake and Garrett Mueller, I think, helped on the stretch in the second half.
G Money,
right?
Does everybody have a nickname? Is there any other nicknames?
Oh, they got. They can tell you what the nicknames
are.
But
there are some other nicknames. G Money, Garrett Mueller. Why not? GM.
I don't think Joe's got a nickname, and he really needs one. You know, I know he's got one. I don't know if he wants to share it, but if they don't have them usually during the broadcast, I try to dub them something.
Yeah,
know,
it's kind of
to
fun
get it going. But we call Jack Action Jackson.
Action
I don't know
Jack
if he likes it.
Jay Buckets right here.
Jay Buckets, yep.
Buckets. It goes as daddy.
All right.
Purely a basketball reference. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but you can have, as a sportscaster, you can have fun with the nicknames.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
G Money going straight to the bank with that one.
That's
or
right.
Whatever. You know, keep the change.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
I'm out. So, all right. Should we look at the next clip? Or
sure.
Okay.
So there's a big. They're playing well. They're getting the ball where they want it. Got to convert the free throws. Mueller out high, rubs off the screen. Pete Hahn. Lex drives the lane late night. Lex Hahn gets the basket. Oh, and there's a ball thrown in, and Clay beats everybody to it.
Oh, no!
Everybody to it.
Oh,
to
no!
To oh, no! To take the lead. They get it to Irwin. Blocked by Wieskamp. Sampson with the rebound. They'll get Irwin again. Blocked by Howard. Ball on the floor. Muscatine's having a block party.
Green Hahn in the front court for the Muskies. They get it to Wieskamp. He's guarded by Wilkerson. Swings it to Howard in the left wing. Clock at 7:15. They get it to Mueller. Three out of the corner. Good. G Money knocks down a three, and the Muskies go on top. Three zip to start this one. Brendan Lee, I'm sure this is his only high school start. Wieskamp for three. Good. He matches it. 1 minute to play in the half. We're tied at 27. Joe at the elbow to Greenaw. He'll take a three left wing. Good. Drew Greenaw with a rare three.
Boy, if he can,
30 to 27 Muskies.
If he can start knocking those down, Brian.
Wieskamp crossover on Seals to Greenhaw. They're giving him three, and he turns this one down. Now he feeds it into Howard. Spin move, shot. Good. Bryce Howard with a nice shot. Mueller at the elbow to Webking. Back to Joe. Joe bounces Batista. Wide open corner three. Good. Alex Batista. Oh. Swings in on Buffelli, picks it up, gets it to Webking. He'll take a shot. Good, Derek Webking. A great pass from Falk. Double team in Wieskamp. He throws to Falk. He'll take another three. Good, Jack Falk with three threes here in the fourth. Pulls up from three. No good. Rebound Buffelli. He goes strong. Runs over Greenhaw. Offensive foul. Muskie ball. Drew Greenhaw with great defense.
And here comes Lynn.
Okay, let's talk about that game a little bit.
The North Scott road win, to me, I'm not a player, but all the years I've been covering basketball games and going up there, and it's a great place to call a game. The pit is just phenomenal. You're right on the court. And we've taken our lumps. I mean, we've literally gotten our rear ends handed to us many nights up there. And to me, that was the sweetest win of the year to call and watch. It's a great program with a great coach. Seamus Buddy does a great job up there. And they've always got a very good team and good players. So sweeping North Scott this year, I think, has got to be pretty high on the list for these guys this season.
What do you guys think? What does that bring back some memories? What are your thoughts on that particular game?
I mean, yeah. I mean, playing up there, I actually didn't get to play. I was injured, unfortunately. But, I mean, watching them win there, I mean, I don't think I've ever been alive when they ever won there, to be honest.
Yeah,
so I can't remember a time.
Yeah.
They actually went up there and watched a game that we won. So it's incredible to watch us play and just be a part of the team, like I said.
Okay, Joe, what are your thoughts on that game?
Oh, yeah, my first time ever playing at the Pit at the high school level. We lost by 45.
Wow.
So coming in there this year and being able to get that win, it was just a great confidence builder and just very exciting.
Okay, so you've scored quite a few points, but we're showing a lot of opportunities where you pass a lot and you're always looking for your teammate support. Talk a little bit about your teammates and what role they've played in your success.
Oh yeah, this year I've kind of focused on trying to get my teammates more involved, just being more of a distributor, playing the point guard. So having guys around me that can knock down shots when I'm getting double teamed or whatever,
right.
It helps getting the flow of the game. And when everyone's knocking out shots, it's a lot more fun for everyone to play.
Yeah, good. Okay, well, let's see what we got next on the highlight reel of fame here.
On the run out. He feeds Hutcherson, rejected by Wieskamp, and out of bounds. Joe Wieskamp with the hammer. Wieskamp ahead for Falk, corner for Mueller. Garrett drives in, gets it to Webking, to Mussehl. He'll take a three from the wing. Good! Jake Mussehl with his second three. Drives into the paint, kicks it for Falk. Jack drives the lane, shot on the way. Good, and a foul! Jack Falk goes into full flex mode. Wieskamp, hesitation dribble to Batista. Now they kick it back to Joe. Joe's going to take a three. Shot up and in. Wieskamp buries a three. He bounces it for Wieskamp and the Muskies reset. Screen roll out high. Joe flips it into Jake, kicks it over to Mueller for three. Good! Good ball movement by the Muskies. There's a double team on Joe. They kick it to Mueller. Mueller to Falk. Over to Wieskamp, a long three. God, Joe Wieskamp with 30. And the Muskies go up 64-58. In the front court, Seals on the left wing. Drives into the lane, shot on the way. Blocked by Mueller. G-Money with a block. 66-61. Webking drives the lane to Mueller. Mueller to Mussehl. He'll take another three. Good! Jake Mussehl has found his range, and that's his fourth three of the second half. And that's what they can't do. The Muskies have got to make him go one and done. Grotheson set to check in for Bendorf. Wieskamp for three, top of the key. Good. Joe buries it, and it's 9-5. Mussehl. Down the floor comes Jake. Gets it to Wieskamp. Lob! Oh! Dunk City! Mussehl with a lob to Wieskamp. Flusheroo for two. Joe had 19 at the half. Went five minutes without a bucket here until that flushed him.
I'll tell you what, when Jake got that ball, Brian, I don't know if you saw it, but he
knew where Joe was.
He knew where he wanted to go with it. I was almost half expecting a backwards pass.
He could have taken the layup, but I knew he saw Joe over his left shoulder and just threw it up perfect, and Joe knew what to do with it, of course. But folks, you got to watch that. Chad Yoakum's here, as always, does a great job with Public Access TV9.
All right, so we'll take a little, let us talk about what we just saw. We saw a few games there.
Saw a few games, and we kind of went back to the North Scott game, which I really think catapulted them in the second half of the season and got them on a stretch run here. Obviously, not all the games are filmed because we go out of town
and
some of those games, but the North Scott win was followed up by, they beat number four in the state, Mount Pleasant in 3A, and then Assumption the next week. They were ranked seventh in the state.
Number four, can I back? So number
yes.
Four in the state, how did they end up overall?
They went to state. Mount Pleasant did go to state.
So this was a real
3A.
Deal team.
Oh yeah, very good team.
So that was probably obviously an uplifting opportunity for you guys.
A 19-win team, so three consecutive top 10 wins.
Wow.
And when it comes to individual performances, the Assumption game on the road is the one that I thought, my opinion was, Joe was just phenomenal. He had 47 points, I believe, 15 rebounds, a whole bunch of assists, and he shot over 60% from the floor that night. I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, but of all of his great performances this year, that to me still stood out because that was a good basketball team, and they ran everything at him, and he just kept beating them off the dribble. And then pulling, you know, it was a beauty. It was fun to watch. You know, and I didn't call that one. I was just sitting there as a fan that night. That was great. So
yeah, that it's kind of like taking your camera to a vacation. At some point, you got to sit back and just enjoy these moments, especially with your son, and just enjoy it as a fan.
Correct.
Very knowledgeable fan. Faulkner full flex mode? What's
full
that?
Full flex. Jack's got a, you know, Jack's, and these guys know Jack. Everybody knows Jack. Jack's a terrific three-sport athlete in Muscatine, and he's going to have a huge role next year. And as the season progresses this year, Jack really, really stepped his game up offensively. Not afraid of the moment. He's always, as you can see, ready to take a big shot. He hit the clinching shot, or not the clinching shot, the shot that took him into double overtime against North at home, a huge shot. Then he hit three threes in the fourth quarter at North Scott when he really hadn't played much the first three quarters. And he came in, and I think he had a different celebration for each three. As he ran down the floor, you know, he had three goggles once, and then he did the full flex and whatever
full
else.
Full flex mode. Like, how do you guys, is there like warning signs that the full flex mode is about to happen?
Yeah,
or is,
well,
like, is it like the Incredible Hulk where it's just like getting ready to flex it out? Oh, no.
I think next year he'll go tight on a jersey just to rip one out. I don't know.
He almost did this year.
Getting tight.
Well, I'm sorry. I noticed some of these fun things that are kind of.
Well, I think you got to have fun. You're a high school student athlete, right, guys? I mean,
full flex mode. Now, when you guys are playing, I mean, kind of a common sense question, but there's some chemistry. Like, if you hadn't played and practiced, you kind of, when you're doing that with backward pass, you know, type situation, do you guys have a chemistry this year, or did you kind of feel that? Talk a little bit about how you guys worked as a team.
I mean, obviously going 4-4 to start off. Obviously, our chemistry wasn't that good. We were getting mad at each other when we were losing, and I think once we hit the break, our coach, he decided, he's like, well, it's time to go. It's time to step up. So, I mean, we did, and we're all close to each other. We like to joke around and like to have fun, but when it's time to go, we go. So, I think our chemistry just picked up during the year.
Joe, Joe Baskets, right?
Jay Buckets. Or Jay Weezy, whatever you want to say.
Jay Weezy. He's got some, doesn't he? All right. What kind of pressure do you feel throughout? Do you feel more and more pressure building up, or is it more and more confidence building as the games progress and as some of the awards and accolades you've been receiving?
More confidence, more motivation to continue to work hard. I don't necessarily feel a lot of pressure. Obviously, people would think that I do because every night the other team's game plan is to try to stop me. But I think that just gives me motivation to go out there, continue to work hard and strive to get better and know that my teammates are going to be open. So if I find them, they'll hit shots.
Yeah, the other team's game plan, I'm not a coach, but I would assume that we don't have to guess what the game plan might be. And that actually probably puts some, we'll call it pressure, but on the other teammates, it's almost like they don't step up. This whole thing goes south.
Yeah, and the beauty, and this team did a nice job, and Joe did a great job. There's not a defense out there in 3 years that Joe hasn't seen yet. Okay. And very few of them have stopped him. If they slow him down, Joe's got a great and unique ability to find open teammates, and he trusts them. And as the year went on, especially, a lot of guys stepped up. And I would have loved to have played with a kid like this in high school. I mean, because you know, the defense always collapses on him. So if you're a perimeter shooter, you're going to have open shots, and he's going to find you.
Nice.
So it's really, and Jay can attest to that, and Garrett Mueller and Jack and these other guys that, they were, and they'll be the first one to admit, they benefited greatly from the attention Joe got. So
if you're tuning in now, it's 7 p.m. Alex, can you add the word live to that current topic? But is there a little bit more on that highlight reel? Just give me an indication. Okay. So that's the highlight reel. What he's doing now is he's just kind of randomly showing some clips, so it's not of past games. So if the viewers at home, if you've got it tuned in, it's live March 29th at about 7 p.m. If you have a question or want to call in, we'll take calls. It kind of interrupt whatever we're talking about, but feel free. He's going to put the phone number up there as we continue to chat about the season. So keep us going with the season and some of the highlights.
Okay. Well, overall, we'll encapsulate. They were 15-7 overall in the season, 11-5 in the MAC, which got them fourth place behind three outstanding. The MAC was, in my opinion, a better league than it was a year ago. So winning 11 games, going 11-5, I thought was a terrific feat for these guys.
Fourth in the MAC. What's the history of what we usually do in the MAC over the years? Because that's what I think is interesting is basketball is not our – it's been a challenging sport for MHS.
Back-to-back years now, I think we won 10 games in the MAC last year and 11 this year. So that's great. I mean, typically, we'd had a stretch there where, you know, 4, 5, 6 wins, I would assume, in the MAC. So this is a big the last two seasons is a big step up. And individually, just to mention Joe Wieskamp, you know, sitting here, obviously player of the year in the MAC, first team all MAC, Iowa State Gatorade player of the year, first team elite all state, first team all area, first team Quad City Metro, and player of the year Quad City Metro. So the only reason Joe Wieskamp didn't win the Mr. Basketball is because he's a junior. And that's an award that I'm sure Joe covets and will work hard to get next year.
What's the Mr. Basketball?
Mr. Basketball, I get it's a senior-driven award, and it's kind of the creme de la creme of all awards.
Okay.
I mean, that's what you want to get, and Joe never talks about individual accomplishments, so I will. But I'm sure that's on his bucket list to check off for next season, and obviously if he plays the way he did this year, he's going to be the front runner.
Okay.
Yeah. Other awards. Individually, Jake Mussehl was honorable mention All-MAC, Quad City Metro, and first team All-Area. Garrett Mueller, G-Money, was honorable mention All-MAC, and I believe he had some All-Area recognition too, guys. And Jack Folk also was on All-Area team. So those guys stepped up their game, and three of those guys are coming back next year, Garrett, Jack, and Joe. So they've got a very talented junior class coming back next season.
Yeah, do you guys feel that way? Let's talk about the next season just briefly. I've got some other questions, but you won't be here, but you probably have some thoughts about next season. What's next season going to be like for you, for your teammates that you anticipate, or what do you think is going to be one of the strengths next year, and what's one thing you might be a little concerned about?
Yeah, I'm very excited to play with my age group. All those guys, we've kind of grown up together playing, and now we're going to be the front guys. Okay. Starting on varsity, so. I'm just very excited to play with those guys. Obviously, I played with them last year a little bit, but they'll be more of key players this season. I think some of our strengths will definitely be shooting. Obviously, Garrett and Jack are great shooters. I think if Bryce and Lex and Josh can develop, we'll be a very tough team.
What's one area that's maybe a concern or that you wanted to focus on and make sure that you bring that up and develop? Oh, we've got a call. We'll go ahead and take these as they come in. Hi, you're on the air with Muscatine Viewpoint.
Hi, this is JB here. This is a question for Joe and Jake. Hey guys, I'm a big fan. I was wondering what your favorite memory was throughout your years at Muskie Basketball.
Favorite memory, okay. Well, thanks for that question. We'll let you go as they answer that for you. JB, is that a... Is that what I heard?
Yeah.
Do we know, you know who that is?
He's a good friend.
Yeah, okay.
Really good friend. My greatest high school memory this year was on the highlight reel when I threw the ball to Joe for a lob. I actually saw him coming in the corner of my eye, and I knew he was going to get it, so I just threw it up, and he slammed it, obviously. And I think that was the greatest moment because it's like, I mean, he's my best friend, so it's like a connection that we had, and it was a just amazing experience.
What about you? Same question.
I don't know if I have a specific favorite memory. I think just the season as a whole, getting some of those key wins like Brian was saying, and just turning the point in the season when we were struggling and finish off the season with a lot of wins.
With a high point, yeah. Good question. Thanks. Feel free to call in if you have some questions or comments. If you're a Muskie fan, this is an opportunity to ask anything you want or maybe make a comment. What's the head coach's name of Iowa? I'm sorry.
Fran McCaffrey.
I like the story behind sports, but he's got two sons involved. Okay, we'll take this call, but I want to ask about that as well. Hi, you're on the air with Muscatine Viewpoint.
Yeah, this is Don Blake, a big fan of the Muskies. I want to congratulate Joe on all his accomplishments this year, and Jake for, I don't know how the heck he managed to play that last game, play that tournament game after being, your ankle being like it was, but I want to congratulate you guys on a good season and hope you have good luck in the future.
Great, Don Blake. Super fans, right?
Yep.
Rows above. Mm-hmm. Fran McCaffrey. Okay, so against Iowa, tell me about this game that it was in the state tournament. We didn't win, but that's kind of an interesting coincidence. Not a coincidence, but the head coach of Iowa has two sons. They're going to be playing. What's it like as a father having a son in that, and how do you think that plays into the future of his future teammates?
The game at U.S. Cellular Center in Cedar Rapids was a big thrill for our guys. And the one thing you could tell is you could tell they were a team that had been through that experience, and it was all new to us, with the exception of Joe's probably the only guy we had that had played in an arena before. So from that standpoint, but Joe should answer that, really. He's good friends with Connor and Patrick and probably a lot of the kids on the West squad. So, I mean, that had to be unique. Fran's in the stands obviously supporting his kids, but you're his boy too in 2 years, so I'm sure that it was kind of thrilling for everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a fun opportunity to play against them at the U.S. Cellular Center. Just to play in that environment, in the arena, and to have coach there watching, it definitely gets your adrenaline up. You're definitely just going to try out there and to try to do your best.
Yeah, huh. What's it like being a father? And I'm sure that's part of your drive.
It was great. You know, unfortunately for Jake, he had, you know, it was good news, bad news. He hurt his ankle in the Bettendorf game, and we thought for sure his season was over. They thought initially he broke his ankle. It was dislocated. They said a minimum of 6 weeks, maybe 8 weeks. And 2 weeks later, he's playing against Lindmar. So Nicole Calvert deserves a ton of credit for getting him ready to play. I don't know how she did it. And he wasn't anywhere near 100%. But so it was fun that he got the experience to play. And me personally, being on press row, I just wanted to add this in, because we rarely get to call a game from floor level. And Jim and I are down there. And every media guy in the state was there to watch Joe and the McCaffreys play. And a lot of these guys had never seen Joe live, and found that interesting at halftime. They've seen the McCaffrey boys a lot, and with no disrespect, they're great basketball players, but there was a pretty good consensus that Joe was the guy on the floor that night. They were very impressed. So, and I've never told them that, but they were. The writers from the Des Moines Register, the Cedar Rapids Gazette, the Press Citizen, all these guys are there, and they came to watch big-time basketball players, and they saw three really good ones. Four, actually. Devontae Lane's outstanding, too.
It's almost encouraging that the McCaffrey boys were able to kind of dominate in a certain fashion, knowing that that's going to be a teammate's future, so the future of Iowa.
Yeah.
Do we have any thoughts about the future of Iowa Hawkeye basketball, or even the current state of affairs as we're talking about? March Madness just has come and gone, but talk quickly about Iowa Hawkeye basketball.
My opinion, when he gets there, they're going to be a top 10 team, but he can speak to that, I think. I think they're going to be outstanding.
Because you obviously are interested in basketball, watch the state tournaments, and then Hawkeye basketball. What are your thoughts about Iowa this year and then in the future from your perspective, with what you know about who's coming up and even the other teams that might be challenging you and what their opportunities are?
Yeah, I watch the Hawkeyes a lot and go up there whenever I can to watch a game. They have a lot of young guys that were very successful this season, put up good numbers. Contributed any way they could. So they'll be juniors when I get there. So I'm just very excited to get up there and play with them.
Okay, yeah. So what do you think about this year as far as that goes? Like, with your, you know, what are your perspectives on Hawkeye basketball in general? Or is that your favorite team?
Obviously, yeah.
I mean, now, but has it been? Were you grew up Hawkeye? Okay. Mm-hmm. Didn't know if there was like a cyclone situation, but I know. Did you choose Iowa, or did they choose you?
I definitely chose them. In the recruiting process, they obviously offered me. Lots of schools have interest, so at the end of the day, the player chooses.
Did you have any other temptations? There's different opportunities to present incentives, you know, as far as like what one school might have a great academic program or this and that, but you're born a Hawkeye, so it's a simple deal?
Yeah, for sure. Living so close to there, it was just pretty much a no-brainer for me.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I mean, fans appreciate that, especially if they're Hawkeye fans. So that's always fun. Not the first Muscatine person to play on the Hawkeyes, and not the last, but that's always a thrill to watch, to be at home and be able to support Muscatine athletics and all the coaches and the parents, everybody that makes it happen.
Yeah, and it's been fun. I'm sure for the kids, but it's been fun too. When you go on the road, like these guys said, the Muskies have great road crowds, and a lot of it is a lot of fans that maybe only go out and watch a game or two a week or a year in the Quad City area. They come out when Joe's in town, and which is a thrill for our players because they're playing in front of bigger crowds, and so the true basketball fans seem to be showing up, and that's what I thought was exciting, is this season really went on at Muscatine. We had three or four Friday nights where that gym was, you know, 90% packed, and cake auction night, of course, it's overflowing. But it was a fun home crowd January and February at Muscatine.
So I would imagine the start of next basketball season is going to start right out of the gates with a big crowd. Only thing that might influence that, if for some reason, there's some expectations, or are there not? What are the expectations for basketball next year?
I think they'll, if not be preseason pick to win the MAC, that first or second next year in the MAC.
What are you basing that on?
Well, they've got six good returning juniors. They've got a lot of good, well, they returned the best player in the MAC. And then they've got several other guys, five other guys that played a lot of minutes. So they've got a lot of experience coming back. They're going to have to, I think the two keys, I think, is perimeter defense, I think, has got to improve. And I think their overall team ball handling has to improve. But they're going to be bigger than they were a year ago. So they're going to have more size. They're going to block a lot of shots. So and they're going to score. So
they're going to put points. How do you improve perimeter defense? Basically, jump higher, or be I would assume be in better shape to be able to get out there and then still recover in time to.
Well, that and just being in the right position. You just, you know, if you're, you don't have to be the best athlete in the world to play good defense if you're smart, you know.
Okay.
And if you're smart and get in the right spot, they can answer all that. I mean, they know.
I don't play defense.
Yeah.
How are you and your teammates going to improve perimeter defense? Do you agree with that as one of the keys?
Yeah, for sure. I think those things, and then just getting guys in the offseason, focusing on those key points like he was talking about. So if guys show up and are there to work hard, I think if we buy in early, then we won't have that down point to start like we did this season.
Now, what kind of things do you guys do when you're not playing basketball? Or during the basketball season, I heard that you're kind of busy. So sometimes, do you have somebody that you're that you have to sub in for him, don't you, from time to time, for his date or some? There's a date for prom. Is that you?
I have to do what?
I heard. Well, do you like? Are you so busy that you can't even like take girls on dates?
Oh wow.
Wow. Well, I'm not going to prom this year. I have a tournament, but.
Yeah. Might be referring to last year, huh? Remember?
Last year.
Well, let's talk about last year, because I'm sorry. Just some notes that Chad mentioned that Jake, your best friend, had to go on a date because you were busy playing basketball. And
well, yeah, he had a tournament, so he only trusted me with his lady friend.
She was like,
"That's what we're going to call it."
She was like, "If I don't go on this date, it's over." And you've like, you know,
yeah, Joe, I guess I had to swoop in and
as
do my
as
thing,
a front office. Alley-oop it, we call it, you know.
Yeah,
alley-oop
exactly.
For you.
Exactly. But, yep, I mean, so I just.
As friends are for.
I
what
guess.
Do you guys do when you're not playing back? Okay, so the off-season, I'm assuming you're pretty focused 24-7. Doesn't matter what day, month it is, you know, you're thinking about basketball. But what else do you guys do? And what do you do when you're not in basketball mode?
Well, going through my high school career, once I'm done with basketball, I go straight into baseball.
Sport.
Once I'm done with baseball, I go straight into football. But now, since it's over, I'm actually working a lot more. And I don't know, we just hang out on the weekends and we just chill. We either watch baseball, football, basketball, or we go out to the Y, or we play sports.
I mean,
we don't really sit around because we don't like doing that. It's no fun.
Yeah, so, staying active.
Always being active, so yeah.
Sounds like sports in general. Like, is there any other, like, you know, Joe especially, is there any, like, not a secret, but any, like, behind the scenes, like, what your interests are?
Not necessarily.
Like, you're a fan of, you know, movies or... What kind of things do you guys like? You like Harry Potter?
I like Harry Potter, but a lot of the times on the weekends we'll play poker.
Okay.
We got all our friends.
Because just like taking a break, you know, just completely, you know, taking a break, is kind of interesting strategy to being better when you're on the floor, right?
No doubt about it. What people don't realize is, you know, these guys are involved in sports, but they were playing organized team basketball. I think Joe was in second grade and Jake was in third grade, and they were on some little team together. So, I mean, it starts at a young age, and way back when they were maybe in fourth, fifth, sixth grade, you could see the grade that graduated a year ago with Shella Barger and Ben Morgan and those guys, then Jake's group and Joe's group, I think you knew years ago that they were going to have a nice little run in basketball down the road. You could just tell they got along, they played, and a lot of that starts early. Steve, Joe's dad, is a terrific coach and was a great high school player, and he always did a great job with all those kids, and I believe now he's coached all the guys. He's coached Sam, and now he's coaching Luke, his youngest brother, and does a great job with those guys, and that's what it takes to get teams good down the road, is dads or somebody that'll help with the youth and get them going and get them motivated to play and get a lot of kids in the gym, and whether it's baseball or anything. And these guys, what they don't also know about Joe is Joe could have been a terrific three-sport athlete.
I was going to ask about other sports, but
baseball and football, he could have been all conference, you know, easily if he would have stuck with it. But everybody understands his path. His path was made as a freshman, and you know, so, and he's crafted that very well. He's done well.
Obviously. Where you're in your football team get injured, is that the main issue? Where or what's the main reason not to be in a three sport person in your situation?
Yeah, well, I broke my thumb eighth grade year of football, so that kind of, I guess, set the tone. And then that basketball season, I just kind of fell in love with it. And then I knew that if I wanted to be successful and go to the places where I wanted to go, that I'd have to drop those sports and just focus on basketball.
Okay, makes sense. So what else can we say about the season? We always haven't been successful at boys basketball. Now, the girls team, at one point went to state often. We were a nice run, but boys basketball hasn't always been successful. What do you attribute that to, if anything? I mean, as you said, we haven't beat North Scott since he was born. I mean, that's a lot to that question, but
right.
The conference, the way we're positioned, you know, I mean, can you talk about boys basketball? And we've had some great years as well. But
I think Muscatine, it's a lot of its priorities, and I personally think that there's not very many. Muscatine needs athletes to be multi-sport. They really do. There's a lot of good athletes in town, but some decide, I'm not going to play, you know, whatever, football, I'm not going to play basketball, I'm not going to play baseball. And as hard as it is, and it's difficult, I know what he went through, a guy like Jackson Falk, and I'm talking about the three sports that end in ball. I know there's a lot of multi-sport athletes, but it's a year-round commitment to be in football and basketball to be good. And baseball takes a lot of time, too, so that's a big commitment. And if there's a lot of good guys that could have helped the basketball team that don't play anymore, you know. And there's good players that could still be playing football and baseball, vice versa. It would be nice if they would all, as best they can, stick with all of them. You know, it would help the team in every sport, I think, if they would all play multi-sports. But
what do you think about our conference this year? I think playing Iowa City High and Iowa City West worked out well in this case because you're getting kind of some of the right eyeballs watching the games. If you could change the conference the way they do the conference in any way, would you, or what would you do? Maybe you guys too, because we at one point in the football, you know, the MAC-10 has changed drastically. We play a ton of different teams now. What do you guys think about how the conference plays out?
Me personally, I'd like to just stick with the MAC. I mean, to me, I think they're all rivals because you've always been playing them when you're young. Yeah. Going in football, you play the district now that they call it, so you're playing different teams. I guess that's unique too, but I like going back and playing like all the Bettendorfs and North Scott, and you don't always get to do that in football. So basketball, I like to leave it as it is.
Okay,
just play the MAC.
Oh, it's okay.
Yeah. Basketball's still the MAC.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. I follow that because like the Big Ten. Imagine if they started mixing that up. They did a little bit, but you know, you got your Nebraska, Notre Dame. You know, you're used to playing these teams, and it's kind of fun to then, you know, have like a history when you do beat them or whatnot.
And I just want to mention, you know, Joe talks about the goals next year, Wells Fargo, and that's what their goal should be, is to go to state. But the key for them, the last 2 years, they got to the sub-state final. They had to go through number one Pleasant Valley last year, number one Iowa City West this year. So the key is the first 15 games. And we talked about their 4-4 start this year. And, you know, they need to go out in their first 15 games next year and be 12-3 or 13-2. So they're not in that position to have to, you know, not that they can't beat a number one team like that, but they need to make it easier for themselves and get a higher seed so they have an easier path to Des Moines. Yeah. And I think it's very doable next year, and that's why these guys, you know, really need that off-season commitment to get the year started off on a fast track next year. And I think if they do that, they got a great chance to get to Des Moines.
And you said last year you kind of knew it was going to not really develop until the second part of the season.
Right.
But you're thinking that this coming up season in 2017-2018, that's not going to be a factor? Why?
I would think Joe could answer that because they're familiar with the coach.
You know, I think the hard part this year was Coach Belger didn't show up until pretty much right before season started. So we weren't able to make strides in the off season to get guys the connection, the chemistry together. So I think if Coach is here all summer, guys are in the gym, we're just all getting better together, that we'll be able to start the season a lot stronger.
Wow. Okay. Makes sense. So the goal is, any season, the goal is to get to the dome.
Right.
And the key then is to get there, get in early. Yeah, so you don't have to play number one right off the bat or get a bye. Did Iowa, who won this year?
Iowa City West.
So.
Right.
And that's kind of, I like that because if you're going to lose, might as well lose to the best
Correct.
Team in the state. And it wasn't
a
coincidence. It wasn't a fluke. They were literally, apparently.
Right. But on the flip side, Bettendorf and North Scott played to go to state.
Okay.
And we were 3-1 against those two teams.
Wow.
We swept North Scott and split with Bettendorf. So I'm sure the kids will tell you that would have been a path they'd rather have to get to Des Moines, you know. But that's how they have to earn that right. And they've got to start next year by earning that right. You know, they had a thrilling win last year, beating number one Pleasant Valley at home. But that was a great win, but that really kind of got their attention when we had to play them at Substate too. But it was, so these guys have had a lot of memories, and Joe's got another year to create even more memories. And I want to mention too, individually, I don't know if people understand that Joe is on the verge next year, and God willing stays healthy, to be the state's all-time leading scorer in Class 4A. He shattered the Muscatine scoring records early this season already in his junior year. And if he averages, I believe, about 28 points a game next year, and he averaged over 30 this year, 28's a lot,
yeah, I mean,
but he averaged over 30.
If you think about it.
Yeah,
geez.
It is amazing. But if Joe just has, Joe could have a worse year and still break the all-time. And I know he won't, but if he plays, obviously, like he did this season.
He's got some wiggle room.
Yeah, he's got some wiggle room. And that's pretty high company. I think
Jeez.
We're talking about Jeff Horner here, aren't we? You know, Jeff Horner, a terrific player at Mason City, Hawkeye, and now he's a college coach at North Dakota. So, I mean, it's a pretty high company. And I can't wait to call that game. I'm excited for it.
Joe, we didn't talk about, do you know what you want to do at Iowa academically?
I'm not sure yet.
Yeah, it's kind of early yet, especially he's a junior. Okay. Anything you guys would like to say, Joe, anything you'd like to say to the TV audience, your friends, family, to your teammates? You got a philosophy that you want to share? What anything you'd like to add?
No, not really. Just thanks to everyone for all the support.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks as well. I'm going to shout out to my friends, the Weenies. So thanks for all of us, all your guys' support, helping Joe and I out. And then all your fans, I really appreciate it. It was an awesome 2 years of playing basketball for you guys. And I hope you guys can come out and support them next year.
Well put. Okay, Brian, thanks for all your service throughout the years. Give us a little wrap up, anything you'd kind of like to add? We covered a lot.
Yeah, just, no, thanks for having us. This has been kind of fun. This is new to me, but I want to thank you, Chad Yoakum, as always, going to the games.
Yeah, for sure.
First-rate operation, the way he tapes the games, and I know the parents and the student-athletes love watching the replays on Channel 9, and KWPC is fortunate to keep me hanging around to do the games,
yeah.
And Jim Miller and I have a great time, and Jim's a big asset, so we have a lot of fun doing the games together, and I hope to do it for years to come, so.
Even beyond your children's years.
Yes, yes.
You're a sports fan.
He's the
it's
last
pretty
one.
Obvious.
I got to have something to do on a Friday night.
You
so,
do.
Yeah.
You get a little restless, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Hang out
exactly.
with Jim, not work out, just socially.
That's right. That's right.
And thanks to MPW as well. They obviously have supported local sports by bringing people to the games and the radio station as well. The community in general. One of the things about a smaller town is that we can really get on board with some of these things and really give them the support. And it sounds like the support paid off because when you go to the games. They only lost one home game. So if you're wondering if you should go to a home game, whether it be basketball, tennis, swimming, you name it, the student athletes appreciate and acknowledge the presence of fans and parents and whatnot. So what else are you going to do on a Friday? You know, might as well come out to the game. It matters. It really does.
Yes, it does.
Okay. Well, wow, what a great opportunity to recap the 2016-2017 season. Thanks to all the Muskie players, fans, MPW, everybody that supported the Muskies throughout the season. The cake auction always is a great time to see how the community supports the players. Thanks to Jake and Joe for spending some time with us, and Brian, and for coming out. It's been a pleasure. And we will have see you next week in the show. We'll be talking about the China window. We actually have Glad Chang, who's one of the main investors in that group, and Sarah Landy will be on the show. So we're going to give you a little insight onto great things that are going to be happening in Muscatine in our downtown area. Until next time, though, thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.
Lost control when I panicked at the acid test. I wanna get better.